We're so sociable, we could keep talking for hours.
Yes.
Good morning, everyone. And it is Reign of Christ Sunday, and it's also very snowy out. So let's warm ourselves up by singing In Christ Alone. The minister here at Powassan United Church, and I'm also the minister of Chisholm United Church. Let us take a moment now to acknowledge the territory we are on. We gather today on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe people, land they share with others as a result of the Williams Treaty. Since time immemorial, Indigenous peoples have walked on this land. May we live in peace and friendship on this land as a treaty people. and invite you to turn to the bulletins for our call to worship. Come, Christ, it's time. Let your reign begin.
Time for us to choose world leaders who will be faithful missionaries.
Come, Christ, it's time. Let your reign begin.
Time for us to consider the environment and work to combat climate change.
Come, Christ, it's time. Let your reign begin.
Time for us to listen to children and answer your questions directly.
Come, Christ, it's time. Let your reign begin.
Time for us to work for respect, equality, and justice.
Come, Christ, it's time. Let your reign begin.
Time for us to have faithful confidence. Time for us to love unreservedly.
Come, Christ, it's time to let your reign begin. And we will light the Christ candle as a symbol of Christ's reign of love, mercy, and justice. And we will sing our first hymn, number 336, Christ Whose Glory Fills the Skies. Rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of the beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Through Christ our Lord, we are forgiven.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
And now we will sing another wonderful hymn, number 211, Crown Him with Many Crowns. This might be easy, but there's young ones in Chisholm, so
it doesn't.
Okay, it's a picture, but I'll show here first to the cameras. Who's this in the picture? I tried to get a modern picture. I've got lots of younger pictures. See, you jumped there. What was the first thing you said? You said Prince, too. We're still used to saying Prince, but he's King Charles III. So, he's king, so it would have been recognizable, but what do kings wear?
Crown.
Okay. And does anybody know what Charles's crown looks like? Well, there's two, one for coronation and one is the state crown. And they're both big. The coronation crown's got gold and some jewels. The state crown has got piles of jewels. So it's quite heavy. So a lot of kings and queens have these crowns. And what's today's Sunday? There's two names for today's Sunday. What's today?
Christ the King,
which is one, and then there's Reign of Christ. So does Christ have an imperial state crown?
He's born.
Yes, he does. Yeah, Christ has a crown of thorns. And I was saying, Charles doesn't have his crown yet. There's a ceremony. What's the name of the ceremony called? Coronation. Does anybody know when the coronation is?
May 6th.
May 6th. And where is the coronation being held? In England. What?
Westminster Abbey,
yeah. Now, I will be in England for the coronation, but I won't be in Westminster Abbey or anywhere near London. I will probably be watching on a big screen TV on a pig farm in northern England. that's where I saw the royal weddings. So, and when that, so that's his coronation. Well, Jesus had a coronation as well, and that's what we're going to learn about in our scripture today. So I cut this out. If anybody wants a free picture of the king, we can put that right there. So is that that thing? I didn't get it out of one of those tablets, so. And now we will start with our scriptures. The first being Luke 1, verses 68-79, and that's found in page 900. It's responsive in Voices United. To show mercy promised to our ancestors,
to remember the Holy Covenant, the oath of God swore to our ancestors, Abraham and Sarah,
to set us free from the hands of our enemies,
free to serve God without fear, holy and righteous in God's presence all the days of our lives.
For you will go before the Lord to prepare the way,
to give the people knowledge of salvation by the forgiveness of their sins.
In the tender compassion of God, the dawn from on high shall break upon us,
to shine on those who sit in darkness, in the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace.
Chapter 23, verses 33 to 43. When they came to the place that is called the skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus says, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing. And the people stood by, watching, but the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others, let him save himself, if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There is also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there kept on deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. He replied, truly today you will be with me in paradise. May these words are offered as wisdom for our journey.
May we walk together in your truth.
Over the last few months, many in the United Kingdom and here in Canada during Remembrance Day celebrations have been getting adjusted to singing the anthem, God Save the King. That anthem dates back to 1619, but the version as we know it appeared in 1744. But the phrase, God Save the King, dates back further than that. It dates back to the Bible, even in Old Testament times. And it is in this familiar passion narrative that we hear the cry, Save the King. We hear it shouted. Those who were shouting, Save the King, had no idea what they were saying. They did not know they were present for the coronation of the king. First, when you look at the place this narrative took place, the place where this narrative was taking place, it was the least likely place for the shouts of Save the King to be heard. When we think of our current context and the upcoming coronation, we think of a grand place like Westminster Abbey. We see our king on a throne, and in the moment in which the large crown is placed on the head of the monarch. Instead, this coronation in Luke takes place in a place that is called the skull, which signifies death. And that place was outside of the city. And it was the place where crucifixions happened. And some more historical facts, because I actually took a course on crime and punishment in the New Testament. The method of execution, crucifixion, was also not the method for a person that would be considered to be a king. Crucifixion was saved for those of lower status. For those who were of higher status and those who were Roman citizens, the method of execution was beheading by a sword. And another fun fact, Paul that wrote all those letters was a Roman citizen. So his method of execution was by the sword. So when the shout, Save the King, were uttered, those who were saying it were mocking him as if he were a king. He would have had a different, and because he was that lower status, he would have had a different method of execution. And in the text, it says that they cast lots to divide his clothing, something that wouldn't have happened to a Roman citizen. Then they raised him on a cross. And instead of sitting on the throne for his coronation, Jesus' coronation took place on the cross. And on top of that cross, there was an inscription written above him. And this was the practice for all who were crucified. And the practice was writing the crime on top. The crime is written on top so that those watching the execution could see the crime. And Jesus' inscription said, "This is the King of the Jews." As Jesus was hanging on the cross, the words "Save the King" were said. And the first to say them were the temple officials. They said in verse 35, "He saved others, let him save himself, if he's the Messiah of God, his chosen one." Then the soldiers mocked him by saying, "If you're the King of the Jews, save yourself." Even one of the criminals who was being crucified with him joined in on the mocking and said, Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and save us." Facing his death and facing the mocking words of "Save the King," Jesus remained calm through the process. And that's a sign of kingship. He could have responded back and argued with them, but his actions and the words he shared on the cross, his throne, in sharing those words, he was displaying the authority of a king. When he was being crucified, he said of the ones who were nailing him and lifting him up, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." He was offering forgiveness from the cross. Jesus, who is one with God, was offering forgiveness to those who were performing the execution because they were only following orders. In facing his death, Jesus displayed authority again, this time in the interaction with the two criminals. After one criminal jumped in on the mockery by saying, "Save the King," the other criminal rebuked him by saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And indeed, we have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." This other criminal stated his guilt of his crime, and he was pledging allegiance to Jesus. Unlike the others, this criminal did see that Jesus spoke with authority. This criminal knew that Jesus was a king. He knew that Jesus was a different king. He knew Jesus' kingdom was different than the kingdoms and empires that he was exposed to in his life. In guilt, the second criminal asked for forgiveness and said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus then responded and said, "Truly I tell you, today you'll be with me in paradise." Paradise in Hebrew was the word for heaven. The new kingdom was ushered in at the moment of Jesus' death. In Jesus' coronation on the cross, this new kingdom was ushered in. From the actions of Jesus on the cross, we learn that this is a kingdom of love and a kingdom of peace. In his resurrection, we also learn that this is a kingdom of hope and a kingdom of joy. The resurrection is a sign of hope. Hope that whatever happens in life, new life comes, even out of death. When the hope of resurrection is filled, there is great joy. Joy that even death can be defeated. Save the King also has another meaning. The name Jesus means Savior. So in yelling "Save the King," they were saying, "Jesus is the King. Jesus is the Chosen One." Jesus was the Chosen One. In his ministry, he spoke up for the poor. He spoke up for the oppressed, and he welcomed all, even those who were rejected by the church and society, and he invited them all to come back to God. Throughout the years, many believe that the kingdom of God is only for people who do good. In the view of many, and there are still people today I've talked to who have done great sins, and those who have never set foot in the church are not welcome in the kingdom. That's the thoughts. And many that I've talked to do not feel welcome in the church because of the way they look, the way they speak, or the way they act. Many, when they think of the kingdom, think that people who commit crimes like murder will not be present in the kingdom. But when Jesus was on the cross and people were yelling, "Save the King," Jesus was offering forgiveness and salvation to all. Jesus in his lifetime sought out people who felt they could never be saved. Like the time he called Zacchaeus to come on down. Like the time he was speaking to the Samaritan woman at the well. And the time he shared the story of the prodigal son who came back. In all of these sayings of Jesus, in all of these stories, forgiveness was offered. In this forgiveness, there is peace that was brought to the kingdom. And there was great joy and celebration when these people were saved and welcomed into the kingdom. As we enter the season of Advent and prepare for Christmas, we do so for the hope of the coming of the kingdom. Each four Sundays in Advent are attributes of the kingdom. Peace, hope, joy, and love. Even in our troubled world this Advent, Jesus displayed these four attributes. As the servant king in his life, he faced death on the cross. Having seen his authority and having seen his power and having heard the cry, "Save the King," we are all welcome into his kingdom. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now we will sing our next hymn, number 327, "All Praise to Thee."
All praise to Thee, O Thou, O King.
now it's announcements for our life and faith and mission. And we do have, and it says beginning, I'm not sure if it began this way, but it's, or it did, maybe I just there, but there's each following Sunday, all are welcome to gather in the fellowship room from 10:30 to 10:55 to socialize before the worship service. Bring your own beverage if you wish, enjoy fellowship with others. So that's a good thing to do. So this Friday is the soup and sandwich bake table and white elephant sale. So hope to see everybody there. Donations are appreciated of gently used or new household items, Christmas ornaments, knickknacks, and donations of baked goods also accepted. But please label if there's nuts in them or used. And donations can be dropped out of the church or given to any UCW member. And anybody here from Powassan who wishes to make a donation to the Chisholm United Church new roof fund who hasn't yet done so may leave a cash or check donation in the PUC offering plate. There's the plates there, and there's one at the back. I saw one donation in there already. And envelopes are provided at the back of the church. And just want to say that Chisholm UCW is doing pudding sales, so that's getting there, and I forgot to pay them for one, so that's a good reminder for me. Next Sunday is the official board meeting, 1:30 in the dining hall, and there's Zoom available, and we'll have that. And November 30th is the first meeting of the Advent Study Group. And we have Babe in the Barn returns on December 4th, begins here at Powassan United Church, and finish out at the Memorial Park. Saturday, December 10th, mark your calendars for our annual open house that Sandra and I will have at our manse on 63 Main Street in Sunridge. So, and you can't miss it because there's all the Christmas blow-ups on the lawn. And apparently somebody from Chisholm, when they were in Sunridge, decided to drive by and said you can't miss it. So that's... Okay, any other announcements?
Omega
and Coral Society is in a couple of weeks.
December 4th
at 2 o'clock. Yeah.
Just wanted to let you know that all the pies have been sold. 589 of them.
Wow.
Amazingly, they were pretty well all bought up a long time ago. But pre-orders certainly work, and a number who either forgot or somehow we missed were a little upset, but that's typical. Every year it's the same, it seems. So anyway, what is so valuable about doing a pie, even though most of us were tired when we finished, some more so than others because they didn't get as much sleep as they normally would. No names. Anyway, I'm so grateful because one of the things I was totally amazed about was how easy it was to get volunteers. That, especially after COVID, because it takes 35 people per day. The other thing I was surprised about was about 3/4 of those came both days. Well, anyway, it's a real social time. A lot of people said, don't forget to call me next year, or if I'm able, I will.
Yeah, and I really enjoyed doing it, and I really enjoyed that I was chosen to be amongst the pastry crew, and including myself, there's 3 members of the pastry crew here. And we're the ones that put it all together, so.
And I might add, I think most of us are very grateful that you did contribute.
Thank you. Yeah. You're welcome. And now, if there's no other announcements, we'll move to the Minute for Mission. And this week's Minute for Mission is entitled, Families Want Their Dads to Come. On November 20th, which is today, countries around the world celebrate Universal Children's Day, also called World Children's Day. The date marks the anniversary of the UN General Assembly adopting both a Declaration and Convention on Children's Rights. On the same day, Restorative Justice Week kicks off. It's a perfect time to raise up the needs of children with incarcerated parents, the all-too-forgotten, invisible, or ignored victims of the criminal justice system. No one knows how many children in Canada are affected by the incarceration of a parent. Back in 2007, the guesstimate was, and I'm glad you're all sitting for this, 357,604. But advocates think that with the increase in the prison population, the number is much higher. While every situation is unique, many children with incarcerated parents face trauma, family instability, social isolation, and economic insecurity. On the inside, parents struggle to stay connected to their kids, let go of shame, and deepen parenting skills so they can successfully unite their family when they are released. That's why Parkland Restorative Justice, a mission service partner based in Prince Albert, Saskatchewan, runs an 8-week parenting course for male inmates called Dad Hero. Hero is an acronym for Helping Everyone Realize Opportunities. Developed in partnership with Canadian Families and Corrections Network, CFCN, the course is designed to educate dads about parenting, how to communicate with their child, and how to work with the co-parent. Afterward, the dads meet regularly in a group that continues to provide support after their release. A lot of people don't think about men inside prisons as a hero. In fact, when we told the men the name of the program, some of them said, "That doesn't resonate with me. I don't really feel like a hero to my kids. But I want my children to look up to me, to think that I have value and worth, that I have information to give them, and can be a good parent that is aspiring to be a hero," says Louise Leonardi, executive director of the CFCN. "We all want the same things for these men. We want them to come out of prison, to reoffend less, to be with their families, and to start a pro-social and productive life, and to move into society in a well-balanced way. Families want their dads to come back. No one is disposable, and no child should feel forgotten. Thank you for helping to build stronger families and for believing everyone can be a hero. Thank you for your gifts to mission and service." And speaking of gifts, this is the time that we dedicate the offering, and we will dedicate it by singing More Voices, number 191, What Can I Do? From the cross, Jesus prayed to God, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." Let us pray for a world that does not know the forgiveness of God and does not consider the lordship of Christ, saying, let your kingdom come. For the rulers, dominions, and powers of the world who exercise authority over human communities, that they may repent of war, renounce oppression, and serve the common good, let us pray to the Lord.
Let your kingdom come.
For the planet Earth that God has given to humankind as our home, that we may be good and wise stewards of its resources, and that those with the power to exploit its bounty may restrain the desire for selfish gain. Let us pray to the Lord.
Let your kingdom come.
For the Church Universal, that all who are baptized in Christ may be bear witness to his glorious reign and serve him in the world. Let us pray to the Lord.
Let your kingdom come.
For our enemies, that we may love them in the way of Jesus, let us pray to the Lord.
Let your kingdom come.
For our friends and neighbors, that we may dwell with them in peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Let your kingdom come.
For those whose bodies are under the demonic reign of addiction, that the power of their addiction may be broken, and that they may be free to receive the gentle rule of Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
Let your kingdom come.
And now we pray silently the prayers that are in our hearts and minds. Almighty God, hear the prayers of your people for the sake of the world. Let our prayers be confirmed in our lives, that we may bear witness to the Lordship of Jesus, through whom we pray. Amen. Speaking of Jesus as Lord, we will sing number 213, our final hymn, Rejoice, the Lord is King. And in love, we are called to share the news of this glorious reign. And you go, as you go sharing that news, may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God look upon you with kindness and give you peace. Amen.
There we go.